Hi, and welcome to my channel. So, a couple of days ago, Spitfire Audio released yet again in their lab series a completely free instrument, and it's amazing, the Uilleann pipes, which is a traditional Irish instrument, and they sampled it. There's obviously a link to download it in the description, and you can check it out yourself. I was so excited when I first heard about this. So what I did is I played around with all the settings, tried to figure out the instrument. And I have a few tips if you want to use this instrument for scoring that can make your life a lot easier, because I think there's a few things you need to know about it and how to set it up properly so that you get the best possible sound out of it. So stick around if you're interested in that. I ended up creating like a small kind of trailer style video for the Uilleann pipes, and you'll get to see it at the very end. Let's get right into it. So, the Uilleann pipes. When you first load up the instrument, this is how it presents itself. What does it do? So, it has, first thing to notice is this is what the instrument sounds like. And that's the lowest note you can play. And the high C is the highest note you can, like the C up here is the highest note you can play. There is, as usual, the expression and the modulation attached to it. Expression is volume. And modulation, it kind of closes and opens the sound a bit. What's interesting, there's a distance knob. That one has a very noticeable effect. Let me play for you from like very close up, which is basically in your face. It feels very, very, very natural. So you can actually control the distance of your instrument using this knob. The second thing that is fairly common in Spitfire Audio instruments is they have a built-in reverb. So if you put it all the way up, it will reverberate for a long time. It's a very beautiful reverb. And then there's another effect that's called drone. Now, this is not really an effect. What it does is it puts in more or less of the, you know, pedal tone pipes. So you can hear how initially the very bassy pipe comes in. That's the moment. Then we have kind of like the two tenor pipes that are joining in. Or let's call them baritone and tenor. I have no clue what they're actually called. They like, for sure they have a name, and I'm butchering this, but you know. And now it's the full sound. So, and here is the first really, really important tip. So first of all, let me shut down the reverb. Let me show you what I did. The Uilleann pipes come with a fairly large set of patches, which is the way that they're included. So there's the chanter, that's the patch that's currently loaded. Then there's ornaments. It has this kind of trill in front of it, very, very nice. But on the other hand, you're not going to use it all the time, right? This is kind of, it's more of an articulation than it really is a patch. And that is a theme that goes along the whole instrument. This is called ascension, which is gliding to the note. Beautiful effect, by the way. Beautiful, beautiful. Then we have a cellular, which will have this random ka-ching going in. Also very beautiful and very characteristic. Crans. Even more flourishes in there. Tides. So the way this effect is achieved is apparently by making the pipe longer and shorter by the player. You can actually really do that. But then you have two, which are called drone and regulators. And here's what the drone is. The drone is actually these pipes. So you can play, like you can see here, me playing those D notes. And that's why you can also get out of the original tune of the instrument, which is great if you want to do sound designy things and are not interested in realism at this point in time. And then the second one is the regulators, which is like this baritone tenor scale kind of thing. And look, if you want to use the regulators standalone, you have to put down this drone effect all the way. Okay, and here's now how you actually build your instrument. If you load up the instrument freshly, you get this the shanta. And what you hear is every time I trigger a note, not only is the main note triggered, but also the drones and, you know, the other things, which in my opinion doesn't sound like a legato, because usually I wouldn't stop the airflow. It's just... And if I make the tones overlap, that works, but the overlap doesn't sound natural because actually the instrument can only create one sound out of the pipe, at least to the best of my knowledge. So this is what I ended up doing. I took my articulation, let's pretend it's the shanta, went to the effects section, removed all of this drone stuff so that I have only... So that I have only the lead. And then added a second instance, which I named regulators because it's the regulators. And in this instance, I'm actually playing this tone consistently. So you can see here in the MIDI, I mean, I'm using this instrument like all the way throughout. So this is like, what, I don't know, like 18 measures, 17 measures, I don't know what, of just basically one note. That's what they do. And then there's another, I'm using also the drone patch, which I'm going to show you here. And this one is used for the very low tones, which is to bring in the regulators and the drones at different points in time to kind of start building up the sound. This is all about emotion, so it's a score, so I want to make it bigger and brighter and go on a journey with the listener. And the other thing that I did is I took the chanter as basically the baseline for what I want to have, for the melody. Now, very important to know, you can actually get two different tones out of the chanter. It does have a type of articulation, and that articulation is vibrato. So it is not velocity sensitive in the sense that it will get louder or softer if you smash on your keys harder or softer. But if I play a key soft, you get a constant tone. If I smash it really hard, you get this beautiful vibrato. So that's something that I'm using very consciously. If we have a look at the MIDI and we take a look at the velocities, at some points, this is something I also edited like after playing it in. At some points you will find notes where I went like all the way up with the velocity. That's exactly where I want to have the vibrato. I have the other patches, the ornaments, the ascension, the crans, which are the three patches that I ended up using, all in the setup with no drone at all. Because the drone and the regulators I'm going to play separate. So I removed the drone from all of these, and now I can actually use them as articulation. So as we go into the tune, you'll hear that this note here has this ornament, ta-dum, which adds realism to, you know, playing. And I'm using an ascension in, like, at the end of this measure, wherever that is. Let me check it out. So right here, I'm using an ascension style. So gliding to the note, very, very beautiful. And here I'm using the crans, which has like this, also this ornament in between. So overall, if I just pick out the melody, I actually have to solo all of these tracks, which will then render the melody. If you want to have a really cool sound, you need to load up several instances of this instrument, remove the regulator and the drone so that you have the constant sound of regulator and drones underneath and you don't have this, you know, interruptions when you hit keys, and use each of them as an articulation. See the small line in here? That's the mod wheel. What it does is it's very subtle. It's a very subtle movement. It's not doing a lot. Always have to use whatever tool the VST producer gives you to add realism and emotion to your music. Now, if we bring in the regulator and the drones, this is then the overall effect. We start with a melody, we use different articulations, and then as the melody evolves, we bring in more and more of the low end of the instrument. And that's now basically the full sound of the instrument. Okay, cool. So, what did I write? It's D major, D major. It's harmonically, it's the most boring thing you can think of. All D major. Still in D major. And now, sorry, moving to the fifth, yeah? So A major. Moving back to D major. Where are we going now? To the fourth. Back to D major. Fifth. First. It's as simple as it could be. The harmony is mega simple. That's all there is. I'm absolutely excited. So if you enjoy the tips that I'm sharing, please hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. It helps me out a lot. And it's free for you, so, but let's get on with it. Cool, so how do I make a proper tune out of this? Well, first of all, I thought we need percussions. And I have loaded up here a snare drum. Then I have the low hits from the original cinematic percussions, and I have the cymbals from the original cinematic percussions. With percussions, this is what it sounds like. Right when the bass, the drones, kick in, I start adding, it just felt right. I really kicked in the snare drum. In those rolls, what I can do with the modulation is I can make them swell, which is what usually a player would do if you want to have like this effect of vroom. So I try to replicate this. And this gives it a lot of punch, you know, it makes it punch a lot more. And then finally, in the second half, when the full orchestra joins, we have a lot of cymbals also to support here with a swell at the very, very end. At the end of the first turnaround, I felt like, okay, we need to make this a lot more epic. How do you make it epic? You add horns. And to make this ultra nice, I added a solo trombone as, you know, support. It really just adds a bit of flavor and crunchiness and power to the horns, which makes them sound really epic. See, you can hear the grit which the solo trombone contributes to it. And for the climax, which is at the very end, I also added trumpets. It's really just to add more of those high harmonics and make this like even brassier overall. And a tuba, in this case, it's a tuba from the PPC orchestra. Let me play it alone for you just to support on the low end with quiver because I really wanted this brassy sound. So at the end of the first turnaround, this is what we get. Obviously, so tuba is a very nice bass instrument, but it is not nearly as powerful as double bass and cello. So I added double bass and cello in traditional octaves. I'm using Uilleann pipes. How about using the Gaelic Voices patch or the Gaelic Voices instrument from the Lab series? It's from the same series. It's a really interesting and very characteristic sound. And I used also the, what's it called, the patch of the E riser, I believe that was the patch that I used for, let me play this to you, I bounced it to audio so I can move it around to sit in a very nice spot. Very nice, very nice, very nice, very nice. And I'm using this throughout a few times. And then, since the women's choir needed more support for the super climax, when the brass goes high and the bass is really loud and everything comes together, we have the men's choir. So, overall, if we put all of this together, we come into the second turnaround. And then I still felt like I needed to add a little bit of, you know, movement to it, because everything was basically playing in unison. We have the choir and the double basses, cello and the tuba, giving a foundation. Everything else is kind of just moving in unison in the melody. And so what I came up with is a very simple kind of thing to enhance and add a little bit of movement. In the violins. That's really it. And it was very, very thin. So in order to make it stand out a little bit easier and be heard by the listener, that's the only reason it's there. There's a bassoon. So that's it. There's nothing left to do other than watch the full piece properly mixed and synchronized with the video. Enjoy!